I am Marcus Sheridan of the Sales Line, and this is What the Speak.
What the Speak, episode 30.
Do you kick ass when you speak, present, or pitch? If not, these expert discussions and insider tips can help you right now, today. Welcome to the What the Speak podcast. I'm your host, Brian Kelly.
If you've never seen the story behind how and why the What the Speak podcast got started, visit whatthespeak.com/speakbetter to watch the 90-second video. If you like what you see, send the link to someone you know. Marcus Sheridan, are you ready to answer the question, What the Speak?
I'm ready, man. I'm excited about this.
Cool. Well, Marcus, you're a pool salesman who's completely revolutionized your industry through content marketing, and now you're called to speak about the expertise that you've developed, not to mention being invited to deliver a TEDx talk in your area. But let's hear it directly from you. Can you briefly tell us about who you are and what you do?
Yeah, man. So here's a really quick story. I started a swimming pool company in 2001. Things were going okay up until about 2008 when the economy crashed. We were in huge trouble. 2009 rolls around. We went through a period of 3 straight weeks where we were overdrawn our bank account. I thought we were going to have to close the doors. And so that's when I really had to learn how to generate way more business than I ever had. Yet I didn't have any money to do it. And it was bad, bad times here in the area. And so that's when we decided, let's just be the best teachers in the world at what we do. In this case, it was fiberglass swimming pools. And so we literally answered every single question, good, bad, and ugly, that we could possibly think of that we've been asked over the years about fiberglass pools on our website. To make a long story really short, River Pools, that's the name of the company, it became the most trafficked swimming pool website in the world. And it's a story that's been told in so many places. And because it went so well, I started to teach other companies exactly what we were doing in terms of the way that we were communicating online and the way that we embrace this methodology of teachers. And because I was doing that on my site, which is called The Sales Line, that's my other brand. Yep. Because I did on the sales line, companies started to say, hey, could you teach us how to do that? Be like that. Get that type of traffic. Get those types of results. And that's when the whole Marcus becomes a speaker thing came about. And now it has definitely snowballed over the last, I would say, 18 months into more than 50% of my income is speaking. And the other 50% is probably consulting. I'm not a pool guy anymore. I'm a silent partner with River Pools today. And now all I do is teach and speak about these principles of great communication and teaching generally online.
Love it. All right. So just to clarify, is there a specific topic that you speak on, or are there various topics that you're usually asked to present?
You know what, man? You know, in my industry, people call it funny things like content marketing and blogging and social media marketing. But if you strip it all away, and that's what I try to do, and I think that's why, for whatever reason, my message resonates with people, because I don't like to overcomplicate this stuff. I mean, if you break it down, what are we really talking about? If you take away all the fancy words, we're talking about, as businesses, great teaching, great listening, and great communication, those three things. And so I'm actually trying to help businesses and people in general become better at those three things. Now, you can call it a fancy word if you want. That's fine. There's nothing wrong with the fancy words. But ultimately, that's what I'm speaking on.
Got it. Okay. So let's dive in a little bit more to your origin story as a speaker. You touched upon it just a little bit, but I want to know exactly, how did you get into professional speaking? Where did it all begin for you?
Well, at first, it started with my blog with The Sales Line, okay? And so there's a couple things going on here. I felt like for a while I was like this stallion tied up and ready to run. And I was just this pool guy going on these sales appointments, and I knew I was supposed to do more. And in one time in the pool industry, it's really actually kind of started there, the speaking thing. In the pool industry, I heard that they were having this national convention where they had all these speakers. And I knew most of the speakers were like 40 years and above old. So I was like, man, how do I get into this? And so this is what happened, Brian. This is a cool story. So I literally went to the National Pool Spa Convention, and I found out who the head of it was. I walked into her office at the show. She had no idea who I was. I reached out my hand to her and shook her hand, and I said, "Hi, I'm Marcus Sheridan, and I'm the best speaker you've never had at this event." And she starts laughing. She thought it was really funny, right? And so did I. And she says, "Well, what do you speak on?" And I said, "Well, what do you need a speaker on?" She said, "I need somebody to speak on hot tub sales." I said, "I will give the best hot tub sales class you've ever had." And she said, "Well, how do I know?" I said, "I have a DVD right here of our company. It's our company, excuse me, I have our company CD that or DVD that we give to prospects. I did this on one take in front of a camera next to a swimming pool, and it was basically a 35-minute conversation. And I said, if you look at this and if you feel good about it, then I will speak for you." And she said, "How much?" I said, "I don't need to get paid. I just want you to try me out. And if I'm worth it, you can bring me back again." And so within 2 weeks, I got my first speaking gig, $500, right? Yeah. And that was it. And I literally put my foot into that door. And then the same thing happened in the marketing industry, Brian. I mean, I was wanting to speak at places because I'm like, man, if I just get in front of audiences, I know that that it's going to resonate. And so I spoke at a lot of places for free at first, just pushing my way in. And of course, now, I mean, all the local places, you know, the local groups and entrepreneur groups, they all rejected me at first. They thought I was weird for contacting them. And of course, those same groups are asking me to speak today for $8,000-$9,000 a pop or whatever it is. I mean, whatever it is. It's just funny to me. And all this has happened pretty much over a two-year period. But that's how it began, my man.
That's cool. So just to clarify, was that first opportunity that you got, was that before the whole you know, reinvention of your pool business?
I think it was happening right about the same time.
Okay.
Because I was going through this period of I want to get more out of my life, you know, personal development and things like that. And I wanted to reach my potential. And I felt like I was supposed to be teaching more people, man. I mean, and what better way to teach than having a platform, which is, in my case, blogging or on the sales line, that's where it started, and then speaking. I mean, I think this is two greatest ways that we can be teachers, is by the written word and the spoken word, right? And that's why I started both of them.
Excellent. All right, so now can you describe for us one specific area that you personally feel like you've struggled with in regards to getting up in front of an audience and speaking, and then how did you overcome it?
Well, I think for me, my man, the biggest problem that I've had has nothing to do with the audience. It has to do with price negotiation beforehand. And so here's the thing. I built a brand on this sales line, Marcus Sheridan brand in the marketing world of personal touch, of listen to everybody, of really giving them my time.
Yep.
And so people appreciate that. And I like, and that's who I am. But then I went through this transition of people were calling me up and they wanted me to come speak, but they didn't have any budget. And so I started saying, I remember one time I said yes to somebody who's going to cover my expenses. And then literally an hour later, Brian, I said no to somebody that was going to pay me $7,500 to speak at their event. And I said, what am I doing? I mean, what am I doing? And so it got to the point, and I think this happens to every professional speaker, that yes, you got to go through the school of hard knocks, but eventually you make that transition and you have to be compensated accordingly. And you can't accept less than that. So the best thing that I ever did, and this isn't for everybody, but because of the demand, I got out of it, and I now have somebody that works for me on a commission basis alone, that is basically a broker. It's almost like good cop, bad cop. I can be the good guy saying, of course I want to speak there, but my broker is not a broker. I mean, he's an employee of the sales line, but he basically says, you know, he can't do this based on these things. And I don't, at least I'm not as much as of a bad guy at that case. Does that make sense?
Absolutely. I mean, that's a great...
That fixed everything, man. As soon as I got the broker, I was like, my life is great. I'm not stressing out anymore about, and I feel like the other thing was, is I come from the pool guy world, Brian. It was like for me to get paid, you know, whatever. At first it was $1,000 an hour, then it was $2,000, then it was $5,000, then it was $8,000. And then it keeps going according to the value, right? According to the value. And so I don't want to just act like it just happens. It's still hard for me to fathom those numbers, right? And so it's hard for me to tell somebody, well, yeah, I don't go anywhere for less than, you know, this much.
Yep.
And because that's the world I came from, you know, I used to, for the longest time, I'd never made more than $100,000 a year. You know, I'd never done that. I'll make more than $100,000 this year just on speaking alone. And that's only, like I said, that's only 50% of my income. And I'm not trying to brag when I say that, but it's just something that it's hard to put my arms around still. And so the fact that somebody is there handling it for me, I'm able to get past that, because the truth is there is many times, Brian, when my price was too low and it turned companies off.
Right.
And they feel like, wow, he's only charging $2,500 for an hour to come out here. He must not be a good fit. And I'm thinking to myself, what a ding dong.
Yeah. Well, Marcus, this is great. I love this because, you know, for those in the audience that really have an interest in turning their passion into something that they can have as a business, speaking about the very topic that they're experts in, this is some really great insight. So thanks for sharing.
Well, I mean, I know I would have wanted to hear these things. If I had to do it all over again, man, and somebody said, dude, you got to get yourself an intermediary. You've got to get yourself that broker, whatever that person, so you don't, because you built this brand on nicety, then I probably would be 6 months further along.
Yeah.
I'm glad I went through it in terms of the learning experience, but if anybody can change that, they can. We undervalue ourselves, Brian. We undervalue our message, and you know, it's like the stuff that we say can literally change lives, and it can change businesses. It can, for some businesses, that could be millions of dollars.
Yeah.
And so if we're talking about a few $1,000 or $10,000 or whatever, that is a drop in the bucket compared to the difference a valuable message can make. And until the moment comes when each one of us as presenters realize that, we're going to be underpaid.
Yep. Okay, well, let's shift to the part of our discussion where we explore your particular expert perspective a little bit. So, Marcus, I want to ask you, what lessons did you learn either before, during, or after giving your TEDx talk? Are there any insights that you gleaned through that experience that have helped you as you've continued to move forward in your speaking business?
TED is difficult, all right? TED was far and away the hardest talk I've ever given. I'm the type that I'm a very interactive speaker. TED's not interactive,
yeah.
Right? I just have this engagement style that's different. So TED for me was a challenge. And in some ways, you know, I looked at TED and I wanted to do a Simon Sinek. I wanted to have that type of result, man. Yeah. I wanted to have 5 million views, and I felt like I had the ability to do it. And although my TEDx talk is in the top, you know, it's in the top like 3% or something of all TEDx's, it still didn't get that. You know, it did like 14,000 views so far or whatever, right, in the time that it's been out, which is a lot and a little at the same time. TED is something that I would like to do again because I don't feel like I reached what I could there. It is an art. Giving a TED talk is an art that is not it's not like your normal presentation. It's not like your normal keynote. And that's why you see a lot of people that are pretty good at speaking, supposedly, they do a TED and they fall flat on their stinking face. It's a different platform. And I think that I never quite fully was able to distill a point of that talk that was memorable and where people could leave and say, golden circle. Why? Got it, right? Which is what Simon did. And I never formulated that well. And because of that, it didn't resonate like it should have. The other thing I found, and this is going to be counterproductive, maybe me saying it, is I honestly don't know if you can look at successful TED Talks and figure out how they did what they did and apply it to you, because it might hurt more than it helps.
Right.
Sometimes there's just no understanding as to why things blow up and why things do not when it comes to TED. Man, that's a challenge there, brother.
Yeah, I mean, it's really interesting because I've had, you know, for example, like Nancy Duarte has been on the show talking about her experience. I had Scott Dinsmore, who was one of those guys that at the last minute he was asked to give a TED Talk. And he went out there and his video is like one of the top 20 TEDx talks. And then, of course, I recently had Carmine Gallo on the show, who's got a book coming out in the coming months here that's all about how to do a TED Talk.
Yeah.
So it's unique to get everybody's take and perspective on that. There's a lot of varying opinions, but I think you've got some really astute observations with your particular experience that it's completely different and you cannot approach it in the same way that you might other presentations that you may typically give.
You're right, brother. There's almost no comparative analysis, and talent doesn't equate to TED success.
Mm-hmm.
That much I know for certain, because I, you know, when it comes to normal presentations and whatnot, I score very, very well. But I know for a fact, when I look at my TED experience, despite the fact that I worked harder on that little 10-minute talk than any talk I've ever worked on, it is the most, thus far, disappointing presentation I've ever given, maybe because the results weren't astronomical and I just have a bar that's too high in my mind. And I think maybe before people do a TED, they've got to say what is satisfactory to them,
yeah,
and then understand how to separate what is a satisfactory like number to the rest of the world, because the two don't necessarily meet. And my problem is competitive is not the right word, because I don't feel like I'm comparing myself with other TED speakers, but I wanted it to be amazing, and the results were just good. And yeah, that to me is not enough.
I gotcha. Well, cool. All right, so let's shift gears just a little bit. And I want to first make note of the fact that I've had past guests on the show like Mitch Joel and Jay Bear who said...
My buddies.
Yeah, they're like, you need to talk to Marcus. And what I want to know is, these guys, they're obviously big names, they think highly of you, and they say things like, Marcus is compelling, Marcus is relatable, Marcus is engaging, this is what makes him a good speaker. And I want to see if you can uncover, like, how do you go about pulling these presentations off to where you get those kinds of comments that people observe, you're compelling, you're engaging, you're relatable. What are some of the things that you specifically do to achieve that result?
So there's a couple of things there, and I appreciate the kind words. I think the number one thing is I never, ever try to sound intelligent. And I never try to impress anybody. It's literally not on my mind, Brian. It's not ever a goal. To me, if somebody heard me speak and they said, my goodness, that guy is a genius, I'm probably going to say to myself, that's not a very good thing. Because if somebody's a genius, it means you see them at this high level and don't know if you can get there yourself. You know what I'm saying?
Yep.
Whereas I immediately, there's a couple things that I want them to feel like this guy's just like me, except I'm a little bit passionate. That's why usually I don't stand on the stage. Usually it's an interaction. And I will literally go right up to you. I will ask you a question. And we're going to start a conversation. At that point, you've almost been voluntold. You're going to be a part of this experience. I think it's interesting that in the social media world and industry, people teach social, but when it comes to the way they speak, they're not social. Okay. Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yep.
It doesn't make sense to me. And I have to tell people, because I ain't going to lie to you, the first 5 to 10 minutes of me speaking, a lot of people in the audience are like, what is going on? I'm not used to this. And you have to go through this period of discomfort. So I think another part of this is I am willing to go through the uncomfortable to create magic. they will have a memorable experience. Whether it's a workshop of 10 or 30 or 40, or whether it's 400 people. And this is what I find. Me, Jay, all of us, we have general presentations that we give. We have any speaker does. They have a presentation. They know a lot of the humor that will work and the right transitions and such. But for me, the greatest magic occurs when I ask a question to somebody and they say something. And it's either funny or goofy, or I'm able to run with it. That's the magic, man. And that makes it an experience. I mean, it's not a presentation. It literally is an experience. That's one of the things. There's another thing, and not to sound arrogant, but recently I've gotten a couple of standing ovations, which is rare these days. Yeah. And I found that when I am finishing my speaking and I say, really, and this is a bigger principle that hopefully will be able to explain to everybody. When I'm done, I say, why are you here? You're not here for better marketing. You're not here for more sales. You're not here to better your business. Although you think that's the reason, the real reason is so that you can find financial peace and happiness in your life. And then I will often show how the things that I did gave me a better life with my wife and children, my four kids. I will show them. I will specifically talk about the time I used to have with them and the time I now have with them, how the financial peace I have has brought these things. And so when we think about better marketing, in my case, we're really talking about more time with my kids, more time with my dog, more time to do whatever it is that I love to do. And that brings it, speaking of Simon, it goes back to that center why. It goes back to why we do what we do. And if we as speakers and presenters can help people catch that and see that vision, I think there's magic.
Great. This is some good stuff, Marcus.
Thank you, man.
All right, so now we're going to wrap up with our rapid-fire Q&A. We're going to go through these questions really quick. First thing that comes to your mind, and we're going to start with, do you prefer slides or no slides?
I do prefer slides, only though as visual photos, mm-hmm. not as words.
Got it. And do you put together your slides, or do you work with somebody else to do that?
I don't work with someone, but I wouldn't say I have amazing slides, but each one of my slides represents a story, yep. and I speak in terms of story. So that's the way that I go.
Great. Okay. Who's one speaker that you admire the most, and why do you admire them?
I would say, not to say the same thing everybody else says, but this is probably going to sound like that. I really admire Gary Vaynerchuk. The reason why I admire Gary, somebody once told me when I was first starting to go on the rise, I was being interviewed, and somebody said to me once, you're like the Gary Vaynerchuk of pool guys. And I said, well, thanks, but who's Gary Vaynerchuk? I had no idea who he was. I mean, I had never heard of him. And then I went home and I watched him. I said, okay, I'm kind of like Gary, just with a little bit of a filter with the things I say, right? And there is something I love about Gary, though. What I love about Gary is that I feel he, too, when I watched him, I think he's truly passionate, not fake passionate, truly passionate. I think he's willing to be real, transparent, and honest and let go of those 5% that hate his guts and embrace the 95% that love him, which I think is magic for any speaker. And I think he's totally sincere. And because of that, I think he's very, very good. I think, people say, I can't be like Gary. Of course you can be like Gary. It's just, you don't have to mimic him. But when we're talking about sincerity, when we're talking about being you, and when we're talking about being passionate in your way, then you can absolutely do that.
Good. That's a great model to follow. Okay, so what's the craziest, funniest, most ridiculous, maybe even scary thing that's happened to you on stage when giving a presentation?
So I'm just going to use one example. And this is, people are going to, I think if they can envision what happened, they'll really like this. I like to talk about the importance of transparency in our website and how we should address the question of pricing. Doesn't mean that we say necessarily how much everything costs, but we're willing to address it because if we're not, the person's going to leave and hate our guts, right? Because we're hiding it from them and they don't like that. And so I once asked an audience of about 200 people, and I was standing in the crowd. I'm like, how many of you get frustrated and mad when you look for how much something costs and you can't find it? And everybody raised their hand. And I said, why? And they felt, oh, we feel like they're hiding it from us and they owe it to us. And I'm like, good. And then I said, how many of you actually address the question of cost and price on your website? And three people in the audience raised their hand. And then I went up to this one guy who I pre-selected because he looked like he might be a feisty. And I went up to him and I said, so tell me, why do you, one second, tell me it makes you mad, and the next second you tell me you don't do it? I'm curious. Why? And he all of a sudden starts to just, like, you could tell he's having this inner turmoil. And we just start kind of having this interaction. And he gets upset. And he actually gets upset in front of everybody and starts to go at me as a speaker. And I'm standing, like, literally with him in the crowd, and everybody's watching it, and they don't know what's happening. Or they know what's happening, but they're like, wow, this is kind of intense. Well, that moment, I literally stopped everything. I said, let's just stop for a second. I want everybody to notice what is going on right now. What is going on right now is he is uncomfortable. That is a good thing. Everybody else in here is uncomfortable because we are all realizing that the way we prefer it is not the way we're doing it. And so therefore, we're having this internal debate. And so I said, it's great that he is passionate. I didn't go at him. So it's great that he's mad and upset, and he's mad and upset with me, because this is the only way we can grow. And we are here today to grow. Long story short, at the end of the presentation, when I was done, he came up to me on stage. He said, first, I want to apologize. I realized I was a jerk. And I realized after I stewed for the next hour that I was being a jerk to you because I was so angry with myself for not doing and not treating my clients the way I expect to be treated. It was a tremendous experience, but stopping in the midst of everything and analyzing what was going on in a communication setting, that was really profound, Brian. That was a neat experience.
Yeah, what a great story. Cool. All right, so you alluded to this just a little bit, but real quick, what's the big impact that speaking has had on your career, your business, and it sounds like your family life?
Well, thank you for asking, because, of course, that's why anybody listens to this, right? I think we all have a purpose, and we all have a greater calling. I feel like mine, I discovered this probably when I was about 18 or 19. I realized that one of the gifts I'd been given, I'm not good with a lot of things, man, but I did see that I had a gift with basic teaching in a way that people, light bulbs came on. And for almost 10 years, I almost buried that talent because of the fact that I was so busy being a pool guy. And I was a stallion, pent up, ready to run. And I knew it. And then my business partners, they also knew it. They saw me start to present and they said, you need to run. Go. And this was so amazing because most people aren't like that. They shared the vision. So they let me run. And now today, I am utterly amazed that I'm able to teach and influence so many people on so many different levels. And let me tell you one little example of how this has changed my life. And this might sound so silly, but it's one of the most satisfying things. Today, Brian, my wife can go to the grocery store and she can buy whatever she wants. And that's a big deal to me, because there was a time when she could not. Today she can. And that's one small example, but it's a big example of how speaking and communicating has changed my life in a major way.
Nice. All right. So, Marcus, I want to thank you for your time here. We're going to have all the links to your website, to your social media profiles, and any other resources back over in the show notes at whatthespeak.com. It was great to have you share your expertise, your personal story, and insights into how you truly kick ass when you speak, present, and pitch.
Thank you, brother. What to speak, man? What to speak?
That's right. What to speak? Today's guest certainly had some amazing insights they shared. If you'd like to purchase a copy of their latest book, visit this episode's show notes over at whatthespeak.com and click the link at the bottom of the page to immediately order their book.
All right, here we go with the outro.
Thanks so much for joining us today on What the Speak. Be sure to visit whatthespeak.com for show notes on every episode and to sign up for our email list to stay updated on resources that'll help you kick ass when you speak, present, or pitch.